You know, there's a lot of stuff happening right now. I don't know if you've seen the news or not, but all kinds of things are going on. I love it. What you're seeing is the Antichrist spirit screaming, rebelling, they're protesting, they're doing everything. What you're seeing is demonic being exposed. Because they have no understanding of the eternal. So they're coming against everything that they can. Remember, it is the year of exposure. Amen? One of the things that the Lord said, he said, listen, you're to do something very important. You're to get wisdom. But in getting wisdom, you're to get understanding. This is the difference. And this can only come by the interpretation from the Holy Spirit. He said, there'll be many of those who say they know me, but don't know me because they don't have my spirit. Does everybody understand that? See, there's a difference in walking in the spirit and walking in the flesh and calling yourself a Christian. Amen. There's a difference. There's a place where the old man is still running the Christian's life instead of the new man running the Christian's life. There's a difference. See, because when the new man is running the life by the direction of the Holy Spirit, that's called walking in the Spirit. But when the old man is ruling the new creation, it's called walking in the flesh. And there's a difference. And in this right now, there is we are such in such a time where not only did he say that there be many false prophets and many false teachers, and many will run to places to with itching ears and so forth. Because many people don't want to hear the truth. And many people don't love the truth. And there is a difference. And what we're beginning to see is the separation between the goat and the sheep and the separation between wicked and righteousness. These are manifesting. The word says that everything's going to hit a climax before the Lord returns. And that's what we're watching right now. There'll be a process of an increase of wickedness. There'll be more things going getting ready to happen. But there is a place where you and I must stand in everything. Now, there's a process. We've talked in the last couple of times that we've gathered together about the arena of the difference between living in the old man and living in the new man and how the anointing protects the new man. But there's a process. We talked about the arena to where we are either connected or disconnected, and the enemy wants to disconnect us in everything that he can do. And he uses not only the demonic forces to influence the old man and influence the new man, but he's trying to get the old man to come alive again. So in this time that you and I are in, there's a process that we need to do every single day. Before you can connect, you must disconnect. And I want to share about a process of disconnect so that you can connect. Is everybody with me? In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, to connect is the first disconnect. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and we're going to start at verse 1. It says, we then are as workers together with them also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in what? In vain. In other words, the plan of God in vain. For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, in a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We give no offense in anything that our ministry may not be blamed. But in all things we commend ourselves as ministers of God, in much patience, in tribulations, in needs, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in sleeplessness, in fasting, by purity, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Spirit, by sincere love, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing all things. O Corinthians, we have spoken openly to you. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections. Now, in return for the same, I speak to you as children. You also be open. Do not be what? Unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? Now, understand that lawlessness is being exposed everywhere. And you are going to hear of more things. Remember, the ruler of this earth is Satan. You're going to hear more about exposure of pornography, abduction, children being abused. You're going to hear more and more about things that are just wicked and evil and disgusting, because the ruler of this world is being more and more exposed. And people who are associated in serving him are going to become more and more exposed also. Because the word says that lawlessness, it is called the mystery of lawlessness, and that mystery is being exposed. In verse 15, it says, in what accord has Christ with Belial, or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them, I will walk among them, I'll be their God, and they shall be my people. If they do something, if they come out, if they do what? If they come out, if they disconnect, if they come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Touching what is unclean is more than just a physical touch. It is a mental touch. It is a desire touch. Those things contaminate a person. It opens the door for demonic activity to access them. So he says, come out from among them. Don't agree with the voice of the enemy. Don't approve of what wicked approves of. Only approve what God approves of. And disapprove what God disapproves of. Because right now the enemy is trying to get the culture to approve of things that God disapproves of. They're trying to get the culture of mankind to approve of lawlessness so that it becomes more and more custom. It usually starts in Hollywood. It goes to music. And it begins to infiltrate the world system. And then they begin to offer money for people to even practice lawlessness in all kinds of competition. In verse 18, he says, I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, and perfecting holiness in the fear and reverence of God. Again, what is he asking us? To come out from among them, to be separate, to be sanctified. One of the things that we must do is come away from your old man. Amen. Amen. And come out of all of those things that you know that displease God. Anything that you know that displeases him, you must turn away from. Many are not willing to receive the grace of God. In other words, that's called the plan of God. Or they receive it in vain. They take it nonchalantly. See, some people don't even take the word of God serious. They live a life of fake news. It's false news. Just because you go to a church, that does not establish your relationship with God. Does everybody understand that? We never acknowledge the arena of what church we go to. It's who your relationship is with. That's what you call faith. What's your faith? My faith is in Jesus. Amen? It's not about a denomination or anything else. Because there's a desire of the Father to want to have a relationship with the child, his children, his offspring. And in this, he says, look, and I cannot have a relationship with you if you're still touching things that are unclean. If you're still touching drugs, if you're still touching alcohol, if you're still touching pornography, if you're still touching lying, if you're still touching things of your past, if you're still touching cigarettes, if you're still touching these things that cause any kind of separation or open doors, that's where people will really never know the Lord until they die. And that's a terrible thing, because God, the Father, wants you to know him now. Now is the time of salvation. Now is the time to begin to get deep in relationship with the Father so that you may know him. And when you know him, you know you, and your identity becomes true. It becomes tangible. And you don't have to prove anything to anyone. You're pre-approved. In Psalm 4. The process of disconnect. In verse 1 through 5, let's speak it. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You relieve me in my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? And how long will you love worthlessness and seek falsehood? But know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is what? Godly. Do you want to be one that's set apart for him? Then you're protected. The Lord will hear when I call to him. Be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your heart on your bed and be still. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Set apart the godly ones. Why? And those that are set apart, he hears their prayers. In 2 Timothy chapter 2. Remember, your relationship is never based on how much you do for God. Never. Because there's going to be many that say, I've done this, and the Lord's going to say, I don't know you. Because you practice lawlessness. You will base your relationship on the Lord by determining your fruit. Does everybody get it? Because if your fruit stinks, your relationship is poor. Hello? You will determine your relationship and the things that you approve and disapprove of. But the most important thing is you'll determine your relationship in the arena by judging your not only your fruit, but your surrender, your trust. See, because you can't trust someone you don't know. That's why many people call themselves Christian, but they don't even trust God. That's not a Christian. They're so busy living in a life of survival instead of a life of surrender because they don't trust God. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1, let's read it. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in a warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he's not crowned unless he competes according to the rules, house rules, God's rules. Amen? Entanglements. Those are entanglements. These are things that God wants me and you to be disconnected from. In other words, you cannot get connected until you first disconnect. And there must be a disconnect that starts every single morning in your life so that you can connect. Remember, the old man sleeps with you. You wake up with him. Amen. He's before you. You have to get him behind you so that you can get connected. Because the first thing he wants you to think of is you. What you need to do, how you need to make money, how you need to do this, how you need to do that. That is the old man. And one of the things that the Word says is that the one of the effects of the fruits of the Spirit is that you have control over yourself, the old man. Because if you're not living in the Spirit, you don't have control over the old man. The old man is still ruling you and being influenced by demonic forces. Is everybody okay? Amen. So there must be a disconnect from the entanglements and affairs of this world. Why? Because without a disconnect, you cannot get connected. In Ephesians chapter 4. Again, many people don't take this seriously. They're just living their lives through. It'll all be determined and judged when they stand before the Lord and get home. So it may not be manifested while you're here on this earth, but God knows everything behind closed doors. Nobody gets away with anything. Nobody. In Ephesians 4, in verse 20, it says, but you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you heard him and have been taught by him, by the anointing, as the truth is in Christ, that you put off what? Concerning your former conduct of what? The old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that's the new creation, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, putting away what? Lying, which is the old man. Let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and don't sin, and do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Believe me, the old man loves to give place to the devil because he gets fed by sin. Does everybody get it? The old man gets fed by sin. It says, let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. And let no corruptible word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit. What he did is he just told you all the things that will grieve the Holy Spirit. And not feed the new man, but feed the old man. That's why the Holy Spirit gets grieved. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all what? Bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. In other words, that's another arena. Because without forgiving others, God can't forgive you. It's an open door. Putting away the old man is essential. In Psalm 63. So there's the process of disconnect. You know, the Word says, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me daily. Not when you feel like it, not when it's convenient. Daily. That must be your priority every morning. In Psalm 63. Believe me, it's not at our convenience. Serving God many times comes when it is inconvenient to you. But many people say no. They say no. You know why? Because there's really not that relationship. Saying yes when it's inconvenient to you, there's the relationship. Why? Because he's first. Because if he's not first, then you're first. That means you don't have control over self. The old man is still alive. Psalm 63 and verse 1. Let's speak it. Oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. Say it again. Early will I seek. Say it again. Early will I seek you. Seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be added, right? My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. This is somebody who's seeking the Lord. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied with the marrow and fatness of my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches because you have been my help. Therefore, in the shadow of your wings, I will rejoice. My soul follows close behind you, and your right hand upholds me. In other words, he is chasing God. He is not chasing anything of the world. He is chasing God. And the only way to chase God, in other words, he says, deny yourself, pick up the cross, and what? Follow me. That's chasing God. But there's first thing you must do is deny yourself. So you must disconnect from everything associated with you, your past, all emotions, everything. There is a process of disconnect. Romans 7. So the first part of the new day means that you must seek. Amen? Romans 7. In verse 7. Early will I seek you. I can tell you in the last few days, I've been seeking the Lord at 1 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock. It's been early, man, I'm telling you. Praise God, he sustains you when you seek him. And we have the saying, it's a good day to die, right? In verse 7, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, I would not have known sin except through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, you shall not covet. But sin, taking opportunity by the commandment, produced in me all manner of evil desire. For apart from the law, sin was dead. In other words, exposed. The law exposed sin. I was alive once without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And the commandment which was to bring life, I found to bring death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it killed me. Therefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy and just and good. Has then what is good become death to me? Certainly not, but sin, that it might appear sin, was producing death in me through what is good, so that sin through the commandment might become exceedingly sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree. Everyone say agree. Agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but what? Sin that dwells in me. And where is that sin? Your old man. He is sinful. He's the offspring of Lucifer. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, which is now your old man, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good, I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do, but evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now, if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind or my spirit, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the what? The law of sin. In other words, the presence of evil in the old man, also known as the flesh. The flesh of the old man profits nothing, but brings death by serving the law of sin. The new man with the new mind of Christ serves the law of God. We must continue to cut loose of the old to maintain the new. It is vitally important. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, and verse 8. Paul writes to the believers. Now remember, these epistles are to believers. In verse 8, let's speak it. For even if I made you sorry with my letter, I did not regret it. Though I did regret it, for I perceived that the same epistle made you sorry, though only for a while. Now I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that your sorrow led to what? Repentance. For you were made sorry in a godly manner, that you might suffer loss from us in nothing. For godly sorrow produces repentance, leading to salvation, not to be regretted, but to be what? But the sorrow of the world produces what? Death. For observe this very thing, that you sorrowed in a godly manner. What diligence it produced in you. What clearing of yourselves. What indignation, what fear, what vehement desire, what zeal, what vindication. In all things you proved yourselves to be clear in this manner. Now, therefore, oh, hallelujah. Although I wrote to you, I did not do it for the sake of him who had done the wrong, nor for the sake of him who suffered wrong, but that our care for you in the sight of God might appear to you. Now, this is important because true repentance is the starting point of disconnect. True repentance is the starting point of disconnect. In other words, the first thing we must do is seek. As we go to the Lord, we begin to repent. True repentance is essential. Repenting of everything. Why? But repentance doesn't mean just, oh, Lord, forgive me, or I'm sorry for what I did. It means to turn away from it. See, many people, the word even says that many seek true repentance but never find it because they repent but don't turn away from it. That's called not finding it. Amen. Remember, he said, come out from among them and don't touch anything unclean. Sin is unclean. Your old man is unclean. Your flesh is unclean. It cannot be clean. It must be crucified. It can never be clean. It is crucified. Amen? That's why Jesus took on all sin and did what? Crucified it. So true repentance is the starting point of disconnect, to turn away from, to put down, to throw down, to put away, to put under the blood of Christ. And you do this by confession. It's not by thought. And sometimes God is requiring, instead of just a general, oh, forgive me of all my sins, he's wanting you to pinpoint, be direct. Lord, this is what I've done. Amen? This is called true repentance. This is what I've done. I'm putting it under the blood and I'm turning away from it. So everybody got that? Amen. Why? This is the first process in true disconnect. It must be. Sin is what's connecting you to the old. So you must disconnect through the repentance, putting it under the blood, and turning away. Colossians 3. any unforgiveness, you must repent for it and turn away from it. And don't justify sin. And don't fall under the laws that are in the arena that are man-made. I mean, I hear all kinds of laws being man-made. Well, there's a common law of living together for so many years, and it's cool. No, not in the eyes of God. That's called sin, fornication. So quit the, all of this garbage where the world says it's okay. There are things that God says that's what you obey, not what the world says. Does everybody get it? The world says you can go smoke cigarettes and drink and party. The world says fornication is fine. You can be, have same-sex marriage. Oh, this is what the world says, but this is not what God says. Anything that you approve of is sin. Amen? In the arena where God disapproves of. Colossians 3 and verse 5. Disconnect, the process of disconnect. Let's speak it together. Therefore, put to death your what? Members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is what? Idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the what? Sons of disobedience. Man, the wrath of God's going to hit these people. Whether they proclaim to be a Christian or not, they will not rescue you. Is there? Because if it ain't under blood, you ain't rescued. In which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to put off all these. In other words, disconnect from these. What? Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you put off the old man with his deeds. And put on the new man, who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised, uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Perfection. In other words, put to death, crucify the old man. Put off these fruits of the old man nature, called the carnal nature. By what? Casting these things from, remember, it begins with repentance. It starts with repentance. Then there's another process that we go to. So remember, we go to the Lord in the morning, we repent for our sins. We begin to seek him, his righteousness. And we repent for those things and everything. Don't justify nothing. At all. You don't go before God and reason. There's no reasoning before your Father. There's no reasoning before the King of Glory. There's no reasoning before the one that created you. There's repentance. It's humility. It's humble. Knowing that he's the one that holds your life. He's the one that sent you here. In this arena, you first start with repentance. Amen. Then you begin to cast things off. You cast things down. Go to 2 Corinthians 10. So you begin to cast down and out spirits that influence and promote the sinful nature. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Is everybody okay? The Holy Spirit had me start to write a prayer for disconnect. As soon as the rest of my brain returns, we'll finish it. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 4. Let's start at verse 3. It says, though we walk in the physical realm, we don't war according to the physical realm. Amen? That's what he means by the flesh here. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or physical, but they're mighty, or carnal meaning also according to the old man. But they are mighty in God for pulling down what? Stronghold. A stronghold is a memory lie. It's something that you agreed with. Amen. casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is what? Fulfilled. This is powerful. Strongholds are memory lies. They're stored in the memories of your old man. What do? They influence the new man. So they will come up. They will come up. Now what we do, you can't remove them, but you can cover them with truth. You replace them in that arena. But they can't be removed. Does everybody understand? Why? Because once a memory is burned, it's burned. It's also burned to an emotion. So what you and I are to do in the name of Jesus is cast these things down and every associated spirit with them. Our thoughts and emotions and imaginations, conscience, subconscious, attitude, motive, and desires. All of these things, you begin to be led by the Spirit. And again, there'll be assistance for you as the Holy Spirit finishes this prayer. Strongholds, again, are memory lies. They're stored in your old man. The only way that you're going to ever remove them is to kill the old guy. And when you do that, you're going to be in front of Jesus, so you don't need to fool with that no more. 1 Peter chapter 5. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 5. So again, we seek the Lord. We repent for everything and anything. We don't justify. We don't reason. We bring everything that's been hidden. Then we begin to cast down thoughts and imaginations and emotions of people, places, and things. Things that have been lied to. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 6. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in what? Due time. You think that going to the Lord, and listen, don't go to the Lord and tell him you're his humble servant. Puke. Hello, I'm your humble servant. Oh, God, give me a break. If you were so humble, you wouldn't be saying that. Hello? You go to the Lord. You're my source. I'm an idiot. Help. That's humble. Don't go to the Lord saying, hi, I'm your humble servant. Sheesh. Anyways, you just expose your arrogance and pride. You think you need to explain to God that you're humble? Come on, let's get real. You don't think he knows whether you're humble or prideful? I love it. Therefore, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time, casting your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Again, here's the next process, exchange. This is called the process of exchange now. Remember, this whole process of disconnect is vitally important. But there is a process that you and I go through because we want to be disconnected from everything so that we can be connected to him. Amen? So there's a process of exchange. That's what he says. Cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. That's an exchange process. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is walking about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And there's an exchange prayer that we have in our prayer booklet. It says, resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world, so you're not the only one. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and what? Settle you. Now this is powerful. Why? Because the process of disconnect is to put you in a position where you are settled. You are solid. So we're solid in the new connection of creation in Christ Jesus. The process of exchanging. Now, what are we exchanging? Okay, so we've repented, We've cast down, now we're exchanging. I'm exchanging my old for the new creation. I'm exchanging my sicknesses for stripes and healings. Does everybody understand it? You're exchanging everything now. Now that you've cast things down, you've put things under the blood, you're exchanging now. You begin to exchange anything. Anything that you still sense there, Lord, I exchange my old life for a new life. I exchange my presence for your presence, my will for your will, my thoughts for your thoughts, my emotions for your emotions, my eyes for your eyes, my ears for your ears. I exchange everything till I am nothing left of me. That's what you exchange. Does everybody understand that? Imaginations, anything. Anything that you know you're struggling with, you exchange it. Ephesians 4. In verse 17. So we got seek. We got repent. Amen? We got cast down. We got exchange. This is all the process of disconnect. So you can what? Connect. In verse 17. And is everybody there? In verse 4, what did I say, 4? 4:17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the what? Ignorance or stubbornness that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling, that's an emotion, past feelings, having given themselves over to lewdness to work all uncleanness with what? Greediness. In other words, the next part we want to do is cut loose from and sever ourselves from all emotional attachments of all people, places, and things in our life. Emotional attachments. Why? Because that's how the enemy accesses you, through emotion. That's why I sever myself every single day from emotional attachments, my wife, my children, and everything, anything. Traumas. How many, you know, people still struggle with traumas. Accidents. What's happened in your younger life? You've been molested or whatever. You've been rejected. All of these things are emotional attachments that we must cut loose, because these are emotional attachment spirits that reconnect us. And we cut loose from these things and cast them away and send them to the pit. And whatever area it is, whatever has been placed on you, these are also associated with labels. These are emotional attachments and labels. You break those off. You cut loose from these things, and you get rid of them. Why? You want to be untangled from everything of this world. Why do I cut myself loose from emotional attachments to my wife and children and everything? Because, you know, you remember when phones used to have a phone line? Of course, now they don't, but they have waves, right? Why? Because if anything occurs between us, I'm not going to allow the enemy to access me through an emotion. That way my love for them stands firm. It will not be swayed by how I feel. Amen? And I will not make emotional decisions. I'll make decisions of truth, not by how I feel. Does everybody get it? You know how many people go astray because they make an emotional decision? It's incredible. How many of y'all know fear is an emotion? How many people make decisions out of fear and then later go, oh my God, what did I do? Yeah. Remember, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He's out to push. So he pushes people to make decisions. So even if you're going to court and anything, you got to sever yourself from every emotional decision, no matter what it is, so that you make decisions by what God says and not by what your emotion says. When people come to me and tell me all the time, well, I really feel this and I really feel this, I'm like, I have to shut them up and tell them, I don't care how you feel. Why? Because your feelings are deceptive. They're not truth. The only feelings we want is peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit, which is the love of God. That's what we want. Oh, I've been offended. So what? Hallelujah. James 4. Who hasn't been offended? It's what you do with it. Amen. You can hold bitterness, unforgiveness, and open the door for more demons. James chapter 4. In verse 1, where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desire? Some of you all know desire is an emotion. For what? Pleasure. That war in your members, you lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you do not have because you don't ask. And you ask and do not receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasures. God does not promote those things. So when people don't get what they want, they go take whatever they want. When God doesn't deliver what they want, they go get it somewhere else. And then many people say, oh, God blessed me with this. Oh, no, he didn't. He already told you no. Then you went and got it somewhere else. Then it wasn't God. And it causes a stumbling block. Verse 4, adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Hello. Again, in this arena, the war in the members in the flesh, that war against the new man, these desires, these emotions, these feelings need to be cut loose and put to death. Pride is a killer. I'm telling you. See, in the arena of staying humble, this is where many people, they lose giving glory to God. I did this. That's where you got the me syndrome out there. It's not about me or I. It's about him. He's the one that blessed us with the talents. He's the one that receives the glory. Amen? He's the one that's given us everything. Remember, your work, how much you work for God, has nothing to do with your relationship with God. Amen? God can use a donkey. You can take that up yourself. Romans 12. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. I can hear again. Woohoo. My left ear just popped. Praise God. It's on your side, honey. Romans 12 and verse 1. Let's speak it, please. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or your responsibility. So in this process, what you want to do is present your spirit, soul, body, members, memories, hello, desires and will to the Lord as a living sacrifice. Why? You're surrendering to him. Remember, everything's about cutting loose of everything here. So you're surrendering to him, that process of surrender. I committed to you. In other words, I've just given you me. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Galatians 5. So you go through the process of repentance, casting down, cutting loose, and then surrender. Now you're starting the process of connect. But you cannot start the process to connect unless you started the process of disconnect. It's like putting new wine in an old wineskin. Don't work. Galatians chapter 5. somewhere around there. Oh, I'm in Ephesians, that's why. Galatians 5, 16. Is everybody there? Hallelujah. Let's speak it. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Wow. So that means you're walking in the divine nature of the new man. Does everybody get it? And walking in the Spirit is walking in a new creation of the anointing of the new man. And why? Because that new man, that anointing of the new man, that new creation rejects the old man when he is maintained and strengthened. He rejects the old man of the flesh, the desires, feelings, and lifestyle. The new man hates the old man. And the old man hates the new man. Okay. Verse 17, for the flesh lusts against the what? Spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. So there's war going on. And they are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish or you desire according to the old ways. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, which is drugs, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, and anything like it. So it's just more than what's written here. Amen? Of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in the time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because the old man is ruling the temple. And that ain't going to happen. But the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, control over self. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the old dude, the flesh, with its what? Passions and its desires. They no longer have dominion over you. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. In other words, walking in the new creation. Because the old man is still ruled under the ruler of this world. But you want to be ruled under the eternal ruler, not the temporary one. In Matthew 4. Starts with confession. Matthew 4, 4. It's real simple. What's it say? But he said and answered, a man, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So, again, we know that now to reconnect, you are making confession. Is everybody with me? The word of God, the decrees and confessions. Why? Because there's life and death in the power of the tongue, right? Amen. Amen? So the word spoken or sung begins to connect you. It begins to reconnect now. Not only that, it begins to strengthen the new man. It's feeding the new man. In Isaiah 55, so the process of connect is confession, the word of God. Isaiah 55, in verse 10 and 11, I guess 8, we'll start at 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, but we want them to be, don't we? Amen. Well, you got to disconnect to get connected. And then his thoughts are your thoughts because you're exchanging them. Lord, I exchange my thoughts for your thoughts, my will for your will, my desires for your desires. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Again, everyone say, confession, confession. Brings possession, possession of the new man. So what you're doing is now you're connecting. You disconnected. Has everybody got it? You're exchanging. Even exchanging is beginning to reconnect. And then now you're decreeing words, the words of God. Because what you speak is what you eat, and what you eat is what you become. So now you're connecting. You're connecting to the man. You're making confession to possess now the new man and put him in position. Is everybody okay? Ephesians 6. So as you're connecting and reconnecting that day, you're getting ready for war, aren't you? You got to get out into the world. So you can't go out there naked. You need to get dressed with the full armor of God. Ephesians 6 and verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be what? Able to stand against the trickeries of the devil. It's real simple. Now you're out there. For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers of darkness, the rulers of the darkness of this age, and spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. This is powerful, because every day is evil now. We live in an evil world. It's ruled by evil. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on a breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one that's trying to get you to stumble. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. That's what you fight with. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in tongues in the Spirit, which is the seventh part of your full armor. It's called tongues. Being watchful to this end and with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Why? Because when you're praying in tongues, you're making intercession and supplication. Does everybody get it? Put on the full armor of God, Romans 13. Is everybody cool? Is this helping? Disconnect to connect. Hallelujah. Romans 13, verse 11. And do this knowing that the time, that now is the high time to what? Awake out of sleep, sluggard. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry, drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, not in grumbling and complaining, not in rebellion, but in submission. I can go on that one. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh, or the what? Old man. To fulfill its lusts and its desires. Because he'll kick your butt if you let him. Amen. No flesh shall glory. Pride exalts itself. That means the I is always before the person. I, the old man, is always before the purpose of God. And when you fall into pride, you can't see. Its desire is to be seen. Has everybody got it? It wants to be seen. Pride loves to be seen. It loves to be exalted. That's the old man. It loves to expose its works. But it denies the glory to God because it can't deny itself. Does everybody get this? But it promotes itself. Pride is a killer. It is the old man. The lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. It is. That's how that man lives. That's what he gets fed on. It doesn't want, it will not submit to God. And it will not serve you. You have to crucify it. And I'm going to close at Hebrews 3. No flesh, O glory. Amen. Hebrew 3. Starting at verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him who appointed him, as Moses also was faithful in all his house. For this one has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who built the house has more honor than the house. For every house is built by someone, but he who built all things is God. And Moses indeed was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which would be spoken afterward. But Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if what? We hold fast the confession, the confidence, and the rejoicing of hope firm to the end. If we hold to the end. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you'll hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in rebellion, in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me and tried me and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they will not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief and departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it's called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Powerful. The process of disconnect so that we can reconnect. It is done every single day. And every day is a good day to die. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Let this revelation be an impartation to each and every one protected by the blood of Christ. Not that we are strong enough to do it ourselves, but only in Christ's strength can we do all these things. And Lord, let the new man arise in the divine character and nature so that the old man is put down. That we may serve you in true spirit and in power in Jesus' name.